Hi, this is Mishiko, and I'm being lazy. When I have bipods, I like to use them. This is part 4 in our series, looking at a deeper history of the Kalashnikov-type guns. Part 1 was on the AK-47 and AK. Part 2 was on the AKM and AKMS. Part 3 was on the AK-74, AKS-74, and so on. And now part 4 is on the RPK series. Now, going all the way back to episode 1, we said that when the 7.62x39 M43 cartridge was first designed and adopted, the idea was to have a family of guns, including a assault rifle, select fire infantry rifle, a self-loading carbine, and a handheld light machine gun. Well, the assault rifle obviously became the AK, and at the time, the light machine gun or squad automatic handheld weapon became the RPD. Now, the RPD fed from a 100-round belt, and it had a drum, but the drum was just a container. It was more of a traditional machine gun. It had a milled receiver. It used a clubfoot buttstock. It had an adjustable gas system with a long stroke piston. It used kind of a Ditiev-style flapper on the bolt to lock up. And it weighed over 16 pounds. So compared to like the BAR, not so bad. But, you know, compared to the Kalashnikov, even the milled, it was nearly twice the weight. Also, being a belt-fed, it had a lot of mechanical things going on. You know, when the projectile fired, the recoil impulse, the energy from it, not only had to, of course, push the bullet out of the barrel, it also had to cycle the bolt. It had to work the feed system to cycle the belt, you know, extract the old cartridge, feed the new, strip it from the belt. It was a lot of energy needed for a cartridge like 7.62x39, which was pretty low power, and as time went on, it, you know, it's a pretty soft cartridge in that sense. It's a good heavy hitting cartridge, but for what it is. So it worked in the RPD, but not 100%, and it was just barely on the edge of acceptability for a belt fed. In 1955, going back to our AKM video, we talked about how Russia wanted a lighter and easier to mass produce version of the infantry rifle to replace the milled AK of the day. At the same time, they said, to go along with it, we want a larger, heavier, dutier version to go in and replace the RPD, to be the light machine gun, the squad automatic handheld weapon. The idea was this would be essentially the same as the new gun. At this time, in 1955, we didn't know the AKM would be adopted necessarily. But they said the squad automatic, the LMG version, should have a longer, heavier barrel, but it should be very parts interchangeable and compatible with the rifle. So when the AKM was adopted in 1959, the RPK was adopted along with it. It was a Kalashnikov design. It basically stands for Kalashnikov handheld machine gun. It was meant to be used as either a light machine gun, more or less in the defensive role, or a squad automatic weapon in the more or less offensive role. And it really is just an overgrown AKM. So, right here, we have a Russian kit built on a U.S. receiver by Legion USA. I think it's 1969 on this kit. This has a 23¼-inch barrel, so 7 inches longer than the AKM, which is 16¼. It has the same 14mm thread pattern. It just has a muzzle nut on it. We have this folding stamped steel, pretty lightweight, fixed bipod. We have to have a second ring here to keep this long cleaning rod from getting bent. We have two actual retaining rings plus up here. We have, still have the 45-degree gas block, although it's of course wider for the fatter, heavier barrel. We have the same length gas system as an AKM. The upper handguard is essentially the same. The lower handguard is thicker, squared off. Of course, its retainer here is wider to accommodate it. Moving back, the rear sight adjusts for elevation the same as on the AKM. But now we have this additional control to adjust for windage. And this combined with the longer sight radius made this a little better at range, a little more accurate. It doesn't really have any longer range than the AKM, but you can do accurate shots out further. The bolt carrier is essentially the same. The dust cover is smooth as on the original AK. It is about 50% thicker than the ribbed cover on the AKM. Likewise, the receiver is stamped like an AKM, but it's 1.5 millimeters thick stamped and riveted steel versus 1.0 on the AKM. It also has bulges on each side to accommodate a wider trunnion, which is there to accommodate the heavier barrel. Early Russian guns would have dimples on the magwell, like the AKM. Later production ones would not. They would go to a slab side with internal spacers there. I looked very hard last night to try to find an exact day or year or even just a couple of year period for when the switch was made. I really couldn't find anything too firm. If anyone out there knows, please let me know. It definitely seems like the 60s guns still had the dimples, and sometime in the 70s they dropped them. Moving on, we have the clubfoot buttstock. It attaches the same way as on an AKM, but it's patterned after the stock on the RPD. The idea was to grasp it with the offhand here and use two hands to maneuver the gun when it's on its bipod this way. It also has a lower comb, swoops down. It has a storage compartment for a cleaning kit. Pretty well standard pistol grip, standard internal trigger group. This does use a good number of the same parts as the AKM, except for the obvious special ones. But a lot, again, the small pins and springs are the same. These were issued with primarily issued with two types of feeding devices. There is the 75 round drum here, which is a Soviet pattern top loading. There is also a later Chinese pattern many of you must be familiar with. It's actually featured in our AK Magazine's video. Check that out if you like mags, because it's definitely a long, rambling nerd assessment of mags. They also issued a 40-round box mag. The 40-rounder was really more popular. It was lighter, faster to reload, and it was much easier and faster to produce, and it was more reliable. For a drum, this is a very reliable, very solid steel drum, but it still has a lot of the faults that drums. One thing it doesn't have, it doesn't hang down very far. It sticks out on the sides a good bit, but it actually doesn't hang down any more than a 30-round mag would, so that was nice at least. To go along with, we pretty much have a standard sling. Some RPK slings are a little bit longer, but otherwise standard. And they were issued with this shoulder pad for more comfortable carry. The RPK is considerably lighter than the RPD. It's about 10.5 pounds versus 16.5 on the RPD. That said, 10.5 pounds, plus if you have a fully loaded drum, you're over 12, is considerably more than the AKM, which all those guns range anywhere from as low as 6 up to about 9. So I can understand why they issued a carrying pad. Plus, the person who was issued this usually had more ammunition on them. Typically, the RPK in 7.62-39 would be issued with four 40-round mags in a pouch and one 75-round drum in a pouch. No rum. This isn't the British Navy. Sorry. Maybe vodka. Probably vodka. That's not a joke or a thing that they really did. Yeah, the RPK was designed at Izhevsk along with the AKM. It was adopted at the same time. They would get the AKM up and running first. 1960, though, instead of producing it themselves, Izhevsk would send it over to what we know today as Molot. That's why these RPKs, and that's why kind of Molot's the RPK expert in the world. Molot was a relatively new factory. They had been set up during World War II to produce the Papa Shaw, the PPSH-41 submachine gun. After the war, they diversified more. They made some cannons and some heavy machine guns and some even some home appliances. They were located quite near. They had been moved near Ishesk during the war and remained there. So they were close by. Ishesk could support them in manufacturing, getting set up, and any, you know, troubleshooting they needed. And they would start to produce in large numbers by 1961, 1962. These started to go in the field. Russia would issue one RPK per squadron. And they would issue, you know, they would manufacture them throughout the 60s, and they would keep manufacturing. Really, they make a version in 7.62-39 today. It's different from this, of course, but they're still more or less in production in a different form to this day. I don't have production numbers or how many were in the Russian military. Apologies. There's not a lot of detailed info out there on the RPK. What I can say is this was a mixed bag as far as how it was received. For one thing, using a lot of the same parts and the exact same operating system as the AKM was great. Let me see if I can flip this over. Sorry, it's just hard to maneuver two heavy guns on the table. It was nice that it was so compatible with the AKM, for sure. There we go. Let you look at something else for once. On the other hand, we have a fixed barrel. This is the very definition of not quick removable. So it would heat up. Yes, it's heavy. So it heats up slower than on an AKM, but of course once it gets hot, it stays hot longer. So the person issued this had to really get good at controlled burst. Now they did slow the cyclic rate. This used a rate reducer out of battery safety, same as the AKM. But they slowed the cyclic rate down to about 600 rounds per minute, whereas most Kalashnikovs fire at about 650. So it's firing a little under 10% slower. So that helped a little bit. But still, the guys issued these had to get good at controlled burst, or they would overheat their barrels and bad things happen. Of course, the RPD had the same shortcoming. But the trade-off there was, again, compatibility. We're still feeding from the same style. This can feed from the 30-round AK mags if needed as well. It was relatively inexpensive to mass produce. And again, it was quite lightweight. I mean, 10 to 12 pounds, depending on which magazine's in it and how loaded it up is, was pretty good for a saw gun of that era, and is still good today. I mean, the M249 the U.S. uses in 223-556 is heavier than this. So it's a relatively lightweight weapon. So, you know, that was good for soldiers. All in all, once a soldier learned its pros and cons, it seems to have been quite well received. And Russia was pretty successful at exporting these. Not many nations would purchase a license or obtain a license to make them themselves. However, a number would buy a few thousand here and there from Russia to use as their own squad automatic weapon. There's quite a long list online, but nations such as Egypt, Iraq, Hungary, they would all purchase some. Vietnam would definitely get some. North Korea had a version called the Type 64. I don't know if it was just their name, you know how North Korea is, but probably they didn't make their completely guns from scratch. They probably made some parts and called it North Korean, but I could be wrong. North Korean stuff is a little bit of an enigma. China would make a version of this, but Chinese and Russian relations were already pretty rocky by the time of the RPK, so they did their own thing. Poland never actually produced the RPK at all, and really didn't even adopt it. Around 1970, Poland would purchase a few thousand RPK and RPKS, which is the side-folding version, from Russia, for evaluation, but it seems like most of these just went into storage. Instead, Poland kept on using the RPD. I mention this because a few years ago, there was a little bit of confusion when a couple of websites mislabeled a gun. It was the Century M64 Sporter, which was an RPK kit built on a U.S. receiver and barrel. Now, the kits were Romanian. This was definitive. But a few places accidentally, and I'm sure it was a complete accident, marked them as Polish. And so this big Polish RPK thing got going. But I have never found evidence of Polish even issuing in any numbers the RPK, much less building their own. They did, however, make the RPD through the 70s, so that seems to have been their light machine gun choice. Likewise, Hungary, who made the AKM and several variants, just purchased what they needed from Russia. There wasn't really a need to set up a whole production line if you only needed a few thousand. And that was the attitude that most nations took about this weapon. That said, they did purchase, and quite a few ended up in the Middle East, in Africa, and quite a few in Eastern Asia as well. So they would be used in Vietnam and many, many, many other small and medium-sized conflicts, and quite a few would be used against Americans during the Gulf War in the second Gulf War. So this would kind of go around. The 7.62 39 cartridge was well suited to this type of gun. It was a pretty low velocity, so it didn't have a tendency to overheat the barrel too badly, not as much as some later high velocity cartridges would. It was, you know, Russian tough and dependable. And the magazines were, again, interchangeable. That's about all I can say about the Russian RPK. Again, there was a side-folding version. It had the same... It was basically a modified version of this stock. It had a hinge in the back here where it folded over to the right side. We'll look at a version later similar to it. So there was a side-folding version. There was also a version issued with a rail called the RPK-N. And that's pretty much it. It didn't have quite as many variations and offshoots as others. I mean, it did what it needed to do. But these would be phased out of Russian service. They would see use early on during the Afghan War by the Russians, and they would pretty much be phased out by the end as they wore out. Because being a light machine gun type use weapon, the barrels, even though they were cold hammer forged and chrome lined, would eventually wear out. And since the guns didn't have quick change barrels, you know. But yeah, this is the Russian. One nation that did not only issue, but actually began manufacturing of the RPK was Romania. As you know from our AKM video, or probably knew even before that, they manufactured the AKM as the PM63, almost an exact copy. Well, they also manufactured the RPK as the PM64 in their military, with an export version known as the AES. Now, this gun here is a semi-auto AES-10B Bravo. This is really the best RPK and 7.62-39 to be imported into the USA because it is extremely close to what Romania built and issued. It's also very close to the Russian. There's only a few differences. We have the same 23 1/4 inch chrome lined hammer forged barrel. This one has the Cugir scoop muzzle device on it, like the AKM. Most just had a muzzle nut. Late ones would sometimes have various flash hiders. Since it is 14 millimeter thread, put whatever. Now, one thing Romania did was they went to a different pattern of bipod. Early on, they would use the same pattern as the Russian. But sometime in the 80s, they would go to this pattern here, which is pretty neat. It has adjustable legs here, with wing nuts. And it has these two loops here to, you just basically screw them counter to each other, and it quick detaches. It still leaves the collar on the barrel, but you could at least pull the bipod off if you needed to for storage or whatever, or for replacement. The Russian gun, as with most other RPKs, this bipod is behind the sight base, and really the only way to get the whole thing off is to take your sight base off. You still have, again, the collar here, so if you needed to replace the whole assembly, you'd still have to do that on the Romanian, but... The handguards are very, very similar. A little rougher cut, that's about it. Another thing that Romania added later was a carry handle. The early guns did not have it. Likewise, they have a non-lightning cut bolt carrier. A little easier to machine. This one, as with later Soviet pattern, does not have magwell dimbles. It does have plates welded on the inside for strength. Now, interestingly, like the Wasser 10, these come in as single stack. So many think the reason this doesn't have dimples is because of it coming in as a single stack. Really, it's just a coincidence because it wouldn't have had dimples anyway, because that's just not how they've been making RPKs for some time. RPM-64s, I should be. This particular one has the heavier duty smooth cover. Some Romanian guns will have the AKM lighter ribbed top cover. There's tons of photos out there of these on guns. And they're, of course, serial matched as any replacement part would be. I don't know if it was a production change or if they just put rib covers on when some of the smooth ones broke. No one really knows. These guns are an enigma. Most people think of the adjustable bipod and the carry handle as artifacts from a later version, we'll talk about in a minute, called the PM-93. But in reality, later production PM-64s could have these features from the 80s. If you recall, a few years ago, there were those side-folding so-called paratrooper AES-10Bs that came in from Century. They were matching number kits, unissued as far as we could tell, and they were all dated 1989, which would have been still 7.6-39. They were identical to this, except instead of having the club foot, they had a wire folding stock as on the PA-86 or the PM-90, just the German style wire folder that you can see on several things. One other minor thing to point out, just because, when they went to this adjustable bipod, they added this step here on the handguard retainer. It comes out a little bit. That's to help rest your bipod legs on, so they don't have to rest straight on your cleaning rod. Some of the AES-10Bs with the adjustable bipod would have this, but again, all of those matching completely 1989 paraguns did have it, so I'm going to say it's correct to match the style of bipod. There's just very little info out there on Romanian guns, so we kind of have to piece it together. This one has the very common 40-round mag, which is what Romania made. They also produced a version of the 75-round drum. They would issue these with either the early leather sling or the later pattern canvas. This is what came with my rifle, so I just left it on. I really like the sling. It's very easy to adjust, very light, very comfortable. And so, yeah, the AES-10B, one of the best RPKs if you're looking for an import, really about your only option. And Romania still offers a version for export, and I'm sure could still make these at the Cugir Arsenal, whatever it's known as today, Ratmill, Romarm, blah, 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 if the military needed more. Yeah, very similar to the Russian, but as time went on, they would kind of go away from the original pattern with a few of their own twists, and I think they're really neat. I think it kind of gives it a different appearance. Really neat gun. Another nation that not only used but also manufactured a version of the RPK in large numbers was Yugoslavia, today Serbia. These were built at the Zastava factory, and they are truly a variant. They're not really an RPK. Zastava, as you noticed in our first couple of videos, really did its own thing. It took the AK design, but it really modified it, because Yugoslavia didn't have a terribly close relation with Soviet Russia, not compared to some of its other client states. Also, it used some RPK-esque features in its own guns to begin with. The earliest Zastava RPKs were on milled receivers. They kind of get lumped into the whole M64 thing, M65. They even experimented with the quick detaching barrel version, which is really fascinating. I'd love to have one. They would move on when they went to the M70 rifle to an M72 RPK type gun. First with a milled receiver, still. later with this style of stamped receiver, 1.5 millimeter. It's just kind of interesting because they also use the 1.5 millimeter in their M70B1 standard issue rifle. So it's pretty similar. About the only difference in the receiver, this doesn't have the cutout for the spring-loaded catch for the grenade on the back here, because these were never meant to launch grenades. They would do that stamped version known as the M72B1. They would also do underfolding stock versions of this, first as a milled, known as the M72A, later as the M72, either AB1 or AB2. The designations get a little mixed up. I think it is AB1, though, for this one. And I'm sure some other amount of variations, because Zastava was not only producing these for the Yugoslavian military, they are producing them for potential export customers as well. This has a 23.25-inch barrel, like the Soviet RPK and the Romanian. Also like it, it has a muzzle nut generally featured. This one has a little retainer for the cleaning rod to make sure it doesn't slide out on full auto fire. It just came with the kit. This one also has a flip-up front night sight, which is kind of a unique Yugoslavian touch. The bipod is a near exact copy of the fixed Russian pattern. The barrel's a little different though. For one thing, you'll notice there's not a secondary retaining ring as on the Russian here for the cleaning rod. It just hangs out further. You'll also notice the barrel is thicker here. Not a whole lot, but it is thicker. Starting back in the back, they start off at about the same diameter, but the Russian has steps and tapers down. The Yugoslavian does not. And once you get past the gas block, we have these ribs, cooling fins machined in, which make it even thicker and heavier here. You flip this around. As you can see, this retains the sling swivel on the gas block instead of on the handguard retainer, so more AK style versus AKM. The handguards are similar to Russian, but different. The biggest thing I can say is it doesn't have the hole here, but the shape's a smidge different too. It does use an RPK style windage adjustable rear sight. And those are about the only differences between the M72B1 and the M70B1. From this point on, it's basically an M70B1 with a very similar receiver, except for the one difference I already pointed out. It uses the same smooth top cover that the M70B1 does, the same dimpled 1.5 millimeter receiver with bulged trunnion for the heavier barrel, because the M70B1 itself used a AK style heavier barrel compared to the AKM. Going back here, the buttstock attaches in the same way. It goes in with a long screw, has a rubber recoil pod on the back. The buttstocks are the same. Pistol grips are also the same. Now, Zastava did not manufacture 40 round magazines or drums. They just issued these with the standard 30 round. This was kind of an attempt to simplify production logistics and also, you know, slow the rate of fire a little bit, make sure the barrel wouldn't overheat as rapidly, you know, not having to change mags more often. There was hope to do that. That said, quite a few of the larger capacity feeding devices did make their way into Yugoslavia before and during the civil wars from Russia, Romania, Bulgaria, so on and so forth. I would assume if a person wanted, Zastava would still make these today. Again, aside from the barrel assembly, the back half is pretty much just standard, so it wouldn't be a huge deal for Yugoslavia to make these. There was even talk about 5 years ago of Century Arms importing a version semi-auto, like similar to the OPAP, but based on the M72 of this. After all, they imported the AES-10B RPK out of Romania. This gun here is built from one of the old R-Guns kits that came in about 15 years ago. It's on a Nodak Spud receiver marked M72 Sporter. Century Arms also built quite a few of these. They were actually one of Century's earliest AK kit builds here in the USA. They started to make those 2005, I think. If it wasn't then, it might have been 2006, but I know it was very soon after the sunset of the assault weapons ban because they had a threaded barrel. So, to date, no factory Zastava built versions of these have been imported, but there have been a lot of parts kits. This is a pretty nice one. A lot of the kits will have dark barrels, even some will have very worn rifling because these guns were used. So, yeah, the M72, another RPK variant. For completeness' sake, we should also say that around 1970, 1971, Bulgaria adopted the RPK. Originally, it was just like the Russian. Now, I'm not sure on this point, so I'd love to know, have any of you seen a stamped, actual Bulgarian-made RPK? Not a repurposed Molot that was remarked or anything, but an actual, you know, known to be produced in Bulgaria from scratch RPK, because all of the Bulgarian RPK kits I've seen are for a milled receiver. And I definitely know after the fall of communism, they definitely used milled receivers, even when they were doing the RPK LMG, as they called it, in 7.62-39, 5.45x39, and even 5.56 NATO. So I definitely know more recent production Bulgarian guns were on milled receivers. But yeah, the first ones that were made in Bulgaria were built from Russian parts under Russian supervision, which is the common pattern. So Bulgaria both issued and either assembled or they manufactured their own, but I'm not sure if they were all milled or if they had some stamped. Really, it's hard to find any good info on authentic stamped Bulgarian guns. It's kind of a murky point. They got so much from Russia and they rebranded it and scrubbed it themselves. Either way, Bulgaria also had a version of the RPK very much like the Russian. After Soviet Russia designed the 5.45 cartridge and adopted the AK-74 to fire it, it soon turned to the RPK, and RPKS for that matter. What I'm holding here is a RPK-74 build done on one of the few kits that made it in here about 10 years ago. This build was done by Vector, who I'm sure they weren't literally the only manufacturers to do these, but they're the biggest one I'm aware of that actually made a few, you know, not just one-offs, but actually had these on their website in production, and they would offer them either with the wood furniture or the plum furniture. We discussed plum quite a bit in the previous video about the AK-74. But yeah, this is a Vector build. It's all original. These were sold as Bulgarian, but what they actually were remarked, scrubbed and remarked Russian Molot kits, stamped with Bulgarian markings for a few different reasons, but mostly because when Bulgaria went to the RPK-74, they either just purchased whole rifles from Russia, or they purchased the parts, virgin parts from Russia, and assembled them themselves at what we know today as Arsenal. Not a whole lot of extra history to this one. I mean, it's a rechambered RPK. They would go into service a little later than the AK-74. I was trying to find a pretty reliable date. Seems like 76, 77 in Russian production, with them starting to appear in the field in at least notable numbers around 1980. Of course, they saw quite a bit of use in Afghanistan. And they have all the benefits of the 5.45 cartridge vis-a-vis the 7.62. We still have a 23 1/4 inch heavy barrel. This, because it's Russian style, is tapered. A little bit thinner because of the smaller diameter cartridge, but it's still much heavier barrel than the AK-74. It's still with the 14mm threads. They did not go to the 24. But now it's issued with a flash hider. There's a couple of minor variations. They made these a little thicker at different times. It's just 5-port slotted, kind of like it is a birdcage, but similar to the M16 or the Chinese Type 84 flash hider, if you're familiar with it. The bipod's only slightly, the collar is just a little bit different. Bipod legs themselves are pretty well the same. The handguards are the same. Early will be wood, later will be the polymer, the plum as it's known. This feeds from an extended 45 round mag. Early ones like this were the AG4 material. Later they would go to the polymer of different shades, mostly plums of different colors. Like the RPK, we still have a heavier duty, thicker, smooth top cover. We have a 1.5 millimeter stamped receiver. And this does not have magwell dimples, which, as far as I know, all RPK-74s lacked. If there were any that had dimples, they were probably early production or even prototype pre-production. From what I've seen, all the production models do not have the dimples. Moving back, we have a pistol grip. Now, interestingly, this has the concave checkering from Molot. And it is a, this one I think is a really dark black-ish, but it's a shiny polymer, and it would be considered one of the shiny plums. It does have some russet to kind of purple streak, red streaks in it. It's just one of the darker end of the hue. But yeah, these would have the plum bakelite type material grips. And they would use the same buttstock as the standard RPK. And like the standard, there was also an RPKS with a side building stock. Finally, they would issue these with the same style of sling with the pad. This is a Bulgarian sling. It's more green. Russian slings, especially as you get into the Afghan era, will be more gold. A little hard for me to talk about colors, but I do my best. And that's pretty much it. Molot would switch over to making these. They would never completely abandon the 7.62 by 39 as a commercial export option, but for the Russian military, they would switch over to selling them the RPK-74 and RPKS-74. Naturally, they would do a version, adding an N to the name for a rail. They would do a few minor internal changes. For example, they would go to a braided recoil spring for better strength. And whereas later AKs would go to a stamped type recoil rod, this would still use the machine type. These would get a lot of the updates. As time would go on, they were introduced to the AK-74 as well, which is, we discussed those quite a bit in the other videos. The one issue, I can say, whereas the RPK had either the 40-round mag or the drum, and the 40-round mag for the RPK, the 7.62, did hang down quite a bit. For the RPK-74, while they experimented with drums, they never put them into full-scale production, at least not back in that era. Instead, they went to this magazine length, which is a little bit straighter, doesn't have as much of a curve. It holds 45 rounds, and since it doesn't have as much of a curve, it does hang down a little more than the 40 round, and therefore, as you see, it likes to monopod. Not really a problem when you're firing it so bad, but as the cameraman asked before we started this video, you know, just kind of sits there. I actually had to move a book over here so it wouldn't putting all the pressure on the mag. So that is one issue with this. And some soldiers would actually dig a little hole or trench to kind of let the mag go into if they were in a more fixed position. Yeah, these were used during the Afghanistan War. Now, it's worth noting that very, very few nations outside of the Soviet, Russian, and, you know, today Russian Federation nations used the RPK-74. Most that used the RPK were happy with it and its 7.62-39 cartridge. Bulgaria seems to really be the only one who bought these in any numbers. They started to use them around 1985, 1986. This one here is a 1988 dated kit. And that's really about it. I'm thinking, and I really can't... a lot of countries didn't even adopt the 5.45 cartridge to begin with. These included Hungary, Egypt, China, Vietnam, North Korea. They never went with the cartridge in the first place. And a lot of the African nations were not interested in the 5.45 cartridge. Usually by that point, if people wanted to go to a small diameter, they would select 5.56, 223. So yeah, there just wasn't, and of course communism was kind of coming apart at the seams by the point. And yeah, pretty much it. The one nation that would make a copy of the RPK-74 in some numbers for its own military was Romania. You looked at, in the first part of this video, the PM-64, and mine has late features such as the adjustable bipod and the carry handle. Well, Romania would essentially just rechamber that exact gun, naming it the PM-93, and it would be in 5.45. So aside from the caliber change and the addition of a flash hider on it, they look the same. The PM-93 even used 40-round steel 5.45 mags, whereas, of course, the PA-86 used 30-round steel. And most PM-93s had the folding wire stock. However, Cugir has offered the fixed stock, the clubfoot stock version. They would do those. As I said a minute ago, Arsenal in Bulgaria would do a milled 5.45 LMG, as they call it, RPK, but I don't know how many were actually used and adopted. I think it was just mostly something, you know, something to have in the production line. It seems like most of their milds were in the 7.62-39. But yeah, most nations who went with the RPK stuck with it in 7.62 or just abandoned the Kalashnikov pattern altogether when it came to that era. So this is really a Russian-only gun. And that's why the kits are so so uncommon. This is also still in service in Russia. It has not, it's not obsolete. It, along with the AK-74 and AKM-74, is still seeing a lot of service. And that's why the kits have not come in. And now with current sanctions all across the board on Russia, we probably won't see them. It's a shame, and maybe Bulgaria can give us some more kits that are actually Russian but remarked later, but who knows? It's been 10 years and more kits haven't come in. Before we move on, I just wanted to say I bought one of these rifles years ago, 2007. And I sold it to get the rifle we're about to talk about, this one here. No regrets there, but I've always regretted not having a 5.45 RPK since. Well, thanks to one of my viewers and really a friend now who watches this channel and just emails me and we chat. He wrote me an email about 2 weeks ago and said, I know it's not a factory-built gun, but there's a Vector RPK-74 up on AK Files. Hi, guys. And, you know, the guy wants a $1,750, reasonable sum. I sold mine for more than that when I sold it to get the gun here. I immediately jumped on it. In fact, the guy had was out of town, though. I contacted him, and I waited about 2 days to hear back, and I thought, oh, crud, he's sold it. Or he's gone, or whatever. I was really happy when he called me that evening and he said he'd been out of town and got with me. Truth was, he really did have it sold, or he thought traded off, but the guy who was going to trade him backed out, so lucky me. I just, you know, did that, and kind of glad to have another one because they're obviously not doing these. I was really holding out for a Molot import, which they were going to do. There's actually a video on Molot's YouTube. They were going to send some in before the later on in the year, but the sanctions happened, and so that was it. And I was going to just keep a Vepr FM-74 as my RPK-74 5.45 gun, but the 16.5-inch barrel bugged me. A couple other things bugged me, and yeah, I could have converted it, but I would have been the thing probably $3,000, honestly. So I thought the only real difference is that this one's on a Nodak receiver, very high quality, and I'll save over $1,000. So I'm really grateful to the gentleman who sold this to me. He can out himself in the comments if he wants, but I am much appreciative. Nice gun, and glad to have one again. And finally, for this video, this gun here that I like showing off and will never sell. This is my Russian-made Molot Vepr 1V. And you've probably seen it before, but you're going to see it again because I really like it. This is the only true RPK-74M style gun to come into the U.S. Now, in video 3, we talk about all the updates that make the AK-74M. And Molot would follow suit in the 90s after Izhmash would come up with the updates. It's very similar to the gun we just talked about here. Now, full disclosure, the Veper 1V was in 223. But other than that, it's the same as a RPK-74M. And Molot does offer a full auto version in 5.56 for export, which has been adopted by the military of Fiji. So, and they have even deployed them, believe it or not, in service in the Middle East and Afghanistan. Anyway, other side from the slight different chambering, it is an RPK-74M. We use the same flash hider, same 23 and a quarter barrel, same bipod. Now this one does have the dimple pressed devices, hardware I should say. I see the two dimples here, two up here. I don't know if the RPK-74M also has a dimple pressed front sight base. Could someone who looks at a picture tell me? I would suspect maybe not, for the simple fact that this bipod might need to be replaced, and it would be much easier to drive out the pins and drive the sight base off versus drilling out dimples. So I wouldn't be surprised if the RPK-74M, while everything else is dimple pressed onto the barrel, does keep the sight base pinned on for just ease of maintenance. You guys can let me know. Moving back, we have the nylon style furniture of the AK-74M. These are of course RPK handguards. The top is ribbed. The bottom is very, very square. It does have a steel heat shield inside though. Same rear sights, same smooth top cover, same slightly modernized bolt and safety. Now, as with the AK-74M again, this actually has the folding stock mechanism of the RPKS and RPKS-74. It is a little, it's not as quick to fold as, there we go. Folds over to the side, like this. For compactness, there's actually a drop case issued for paratroopers. Very smooth back. This has the more modern Molot grip. You'll see RPK-74Ms with it and with the more traditional grip. This one came with it, so why not keep it on? Another feature, well, I'm gonna have to unfill the stock, aren't I? Yep. The release is actually in the back here in the cavity. The mechanism is very, well, it's the original RPKS mechanism. It just has the more modern polymer stock. If you remember, the RPKS, even with the wood stock, still had a solid stock, still has the clean clip. The release is here and on the inside. Anyway, this has the two rivet style with the one that protrudes in to help the bolt lock unlock, like on the AK-74M. And finally, the magazine. For the newer model, Molot has this horizontally ribbed nylon pattern type mag. This one is in, of course, 5.56 NATO. The 5.45 mag is identical. It just uses a different follower. And I do have 5.45 Russian followers that I can put in these if I want to use this and this gun. So the mags are the same except for the follower. IO imported these for a very brief time. Memory serves, it was 2013, guys? I think so. They didn't really advertise them well. They didn't really get a lot of attention. For one thing, they kept insisting these had fixed stocks, which is just weird. They also said on their website they had 16-inch barrels, which this one doesn't. It's obviously 23 and a quarter. They also had these mags, and they didn't really advertise them. And that's a shame. Nice product, but that's IO for you. We've discussed them in several videos. They are what they are. These are kind of a sleeper gun. I mean, and again, this with the sanctions, it looks like this is going to be the closest we're going to get to an RPK-74M. Some guys have pulled the barrels and put 5.45 barrels in these. I don't want to do that because what part of this weapon's charm is that it's all built in Russia by Molot. If I go swapping the barrel out, then it's no longer all built there. You know, it's almost really a kit gun that just happens to be built on a Veper 1V receiver. But that's my personal opinion. If you've done differently, cool. I'm sure it's a really neat gun in 5.45. Truth is, though, in 5.56 or 5.45, it really shoots pretty much exactly the same. This is the most recent version of the RPK. It's been in Russian military service since at least the late 90s, maybe a little bit earlier. It is scheduled perhaps to be replaced by a new version called the RPK-16, but this has not been officially adopted yet, although it has been tried out. It's also kind of a joint venture between Kalashnikov Concern and Molot, which has not helped the sanctions thing. The RPK-16, for really the first time with the series, has a quick changeable barrel. Of course, it has rails, because everything has rails now. Oh, speaking of, as with the AK-74M, that's what I'm going to title this video. Sorry, I keep having to say it, but you get the idea. They standardized on the scope rail. Before this, it was an option. With the 74M here, it became just standard. You know, same thing with the folding stock and all that. From what I understand, the 5.45 version in internal Molot nomenclature is the RPK-200. With the Russian military just using RPK-74M. The 5.56 select fire version is the RPK-201. And the 7.62-39 version with all the modern updates is the RPK-203, also known as the RPK-M. And while Russia has not really purchased these in any numbers, other foreign nations have, because again, most places, if they're going to do an RPK, they still like the old 7.62 caliber. Well, that's about what I got to tell you on the RPK. You can wake up now and go get some coffee if you're asleep. Sorry about that, but I've always felt the RPK was a fascinating design ever since I saw my first one, which was a kit build back at Military Gun Supply down in Texas a long time ago. And then the AES-10Bs came in, and I got one, and I just went from there, and I don't know, I like it. A lot of guys go for crinks, and that's awesome. For me, it's kind of the RPK. It's just something I'm very interested in. If you have any information that I haven't said here, you know, things, I'd love to hear it, because again, there's just not much out there on the internet or in books about the RPK series, so I'd love to know more. It's just, you know, production numbers and issuance and field service. I'm sure, as with the AK-74M, these have been used in Chechnya and other more recent conflicts, of course, Crimea and all that. Really appreciate you tuning in, as always. It's a really smooth gun. If you have any questions or comments, please post them below. If you like the video, please click like. And if you haven't already subscribed and also like to nerd out on AK stuff, please do so, and we'll keep putting out AK videos every now and again. This is Misha, and we'll catch you next time.